How's it going, you guys? It's Scott with Everyday Home Repairs. Today, I want to show you how to create a solar power sand heater. Now, you might think this is a crazy idea, but we have some used solar panels out in the yard and they're wired directly into a heating element here. This one's just a cooktop heating element, but we'll actually be using some water heater heating elements and then combine a few other components here to see, can we bring the solar power in, store it as energy in that sand, which is actually a very effective way to store that energy, and then use the heat to warm up our room here. Now, this could be used if the power goes out, maybe to heat your basement so your water pipes don't freeze, or possibly a greenhouse that doesn't have any power and you just want some supplemental heating source, this might work out for you. In addition, we'll touch on a few other options you have to make sure you have heat for your home in the cold weather months like we're getting right now. So let's jump into it. Now I'm going to use four of these 320 watt Trina panels. And before you think this is too expensive, look on Facebook Marketplace. You usually can find used panels such as these, and they will have decades of life still left in them. And you might get them for as low as $50 per panel. Then wiring is easy. I'm just going to do in series wiring using the MC4 connectors, which are the standard connectors on solar panels. Then we'll run our two extension solar cables through the side of the window here and just a temporary run through the living room here into some branch connectors. And that will make it so we can get voltage, and then we'll also use the clamp meter to get current to monitor every hour and then run that into our heating element. Now we're not going to use that cooktop heating element. I'm actually going to use those water heater heating elements. So I'm going to try to sink them into the sand as far as possible. And this is just some general sand that I picked up down at Home Depot. And then we'll wire those two together. These are basically resistors, so I just want to wire those in series using these little fork connectors through 12 gauge copper bare ground into inline splices. These are just Wago inline splices that I use for residential electrical projects. We'll do one wire there to bring them in series, and then we'll connect up our solar cables. And then kicking off the day, it's pretty cloudy, but things should clear up a bit, so we'll both get cloudy and sunny conditions during this test. So we've been up and running for over an hour now, and it was pretty much cloudy that whole first hour, but good news is we are starting to get the sun peeking out and the power coming in is increasing dramatically. We'll take some temperature probes here at the front and back within the sand battery itself, and then I have another probe where we'll go a little bit deeper to show you there is actually quite a bit difference in temperature. Even in overcast cloudy skies, you can start to bring some heat inside, and hopefully we'll keep the sun going so we can really start heating this up and then measure, can we distribute some of that heat throughout the room? Can we put those aluminum straps in here and that fan on top and start to move some of that heat? Is this something that could actually heat a small room or not? So that front temperature probe, a little hard to see, but it's about 74 degrees Fahrenheit and the back one's 71. So it's warmer than the room, but not gonna do much in terms of heating the room. Now, if we go deeper with the center probe, we can see we are starting to store some of that heat deep inside the sand. As we see, the center probe will be more like 140 degrees Fahrenheit, but this is just starting out. It's gonna get much, much hotter. So for our second hour, here's the temperatures we're seeing. 114F in the front, 113F in the back. So we are heating up, but the real temperature is in that center of the sand. And I have to use a K-type thermocouple because we're well outside the boundaries of that temperature probe we used originally. Now we're gonna go well beyond 500 degrees Fahrenheit here. So let's see how much solar power we bring in now that the sun's out to result in these type of temperatures. So we just finished up that third hour, but I wanna take a second to make sure you understand what's going on here. So we have those four solar panels and they're wired in series like you saw me originally wire. Then we're just running that through two resistors in series. Those are the heater elements inside the sand and just completing that circuit. Now the solar panels have a rated voltage under their maximum power point, which is set at 77 degrees Fahrenheit for the surface temperature. As the temperature goes down, that it can actually go up. Solar panels will produce more power when the temperature is lower as compared to higher. Now this is dramatically going to change with how much cloud cover you have, if there's some haze in the sky, where the sun's at, how your panels are positioned, how they're tilted. All that is gonna impact your voltage here. So let's just say almost perfect conditions, we're 120 volts to 130 volts from this four panels in series. Because when you wire in series, you're just adding up the voltage and you're keeping your current constant. Parallel, voltage would be constant and amperage would be added up. So that's the relationship. Now using a simple equation, V equals IR, which is Ohm's law, we could get theoretically our current. if we know our voltage is 120 volts and we know our resistance of these two resistors is 21.2, we would expect a theoretical amperage of 5.7. Now, when I measured my second hour, I got 124 volts, so the sun was just cranking, and 7.9 amps, so I was actually quite a bit higher. Why is that? Well, I might want to re-measure my ohms across those resistors. Maybe it's actually a little bit lower than I expected, and then that would explain in actual practice why I'm getting more current. And then we had 556 degrees Fahrenheit for the center temperature. And then the third hour we just finished up, there's a little shade on the panel, so voltage has dropped to 96 and we're getting 6.2 amps, but the center temperature is now all the way up to 860 degrees Fahrenheit, which is actually way higher than I thought it would be. So it should go without saying, but be careful if you're trying this at home. Maybe start off with a couple panels, going across one resistor, how much heat can you create if you're trying to warm up your greenhouse, or just have some baseline of what you'd want to create for your own system. But now let's go ahead and put those aluminum straps in there and start pulling the heat out of the stand to see if we can effectively heat up the room. So now we're pretty much done with bringing solar and heat in, and now we're pulling heat out. But I did tell you I'll touch on other options you have for heating your home during a power outage. Now, if I'm not gonna do what's called a generator inlet and either power my home through a gas generator or a large portable power station, it's good to have a plan of attack on your critical appliances. For me, that is the gas furnace, the refrigerator, and the sump pump. I've done the calculations. I understand how much energy would I actually use per day and how big of a portable power station, like these two very portable units from EcoFlow. This is a Delta 2. It's about 26 to 27 pounds. And this is the updated version, the Delta 3 Plus. Now, the Delta 2 for price and capability is probably my favorite. It has the solar charge controller where you can power this with solar power, 500 watts worth of panels. And then it has the internal battery, 1 kilowatt hour. And then it has the inverter, which converts that DC into AC power, and you can power pretty much any appliance, including those critical appliances. Now, you have to do a little homework, but just know these type of units can be pretty capable. And specifically for mine, I would need the Delta 3 Plus and also an extra battery unit, which gives me 2 kilowatt hours. This one has 1,000 watts of solar input, and this would power my furnace, my refrigerator, and my sump pump. Now, I could do it with the Delta 2 as well. It's just the 500 watts would be a little bit low for me to be comfortable knowing I can replenish the batteries during the day and then deplete those at night. Now, check the links in the description. Different times of year, they'll run sales, and this time of year are some of the best sale prices on these type of units. And I know the Delta 2 is the most popular with homeowners and our viewers on our other channel called Everyday Solar. But let's jump back to the SAN battery and give a little bit more details on how I set up those straps. I just cut a 3-foot section in half, so I had 18 inches for each section, and then marked 6 inches from each end so I could bend these into use. Then I would press those down into the SAN, and the whole purpose here is we want to pull that heat out of the center of the SAN battery, because we saw how much heat was trapped in there. And I'll set that fan on top, and this fan works, that little gray section in the middle between the base and the top is actually called a Peltier device. And that will create a little bit of current when there is a difference in temperature from top and bottom. So with this FLIR thermal imaging camera, the little target in the middle will give us our temperature, and the red target is the maximum within the scene. So right in the middle there, it's maxing out the temp, but this base is about 160 degrees Fahrenheit and the top is 85, so that's enough of a difference to then spin the fan. And then that fan starts to spin, and I have the 3 different thermometers. One is 1 foot away from the pot, then 3 feet, and then 5 feet, showing the difference. And overall, I would say it didn't really warm up the room. That was pretty much the biggest delta that I saw, where it was about 4 degrees between 1 foot away from the pot and then 5 feet away. So it did help the room, and you can see the spreadsheet right here. We'll take a look at those results. I took the voltage, the amperage, and then the overall wattage. How much power are we getting from the solar panels? Kind of peaking out at about 1 kilowatt of solar power. Then we took that front temp and the back temp, which were always in the same positions, and the center temp, which really peaked up there above 900 degrees Fahrenheit. So be careful if you're doing these at home. We're getting up to some of those temperatures where we could cause some issues. And then at about the 3:30 p.m. mark, solar was done, we were shading the panels, and then we started just pulling that out. You can see those temperatures at the center really dropping pretty rapidly, and that's where we're at right now. We're at probably about under 350 degrees Fahrenheit in the center, and there's just not going to be that much more heat coming out of the same battery. Now, you will see the outside temperatures. We were pretty much under 30 degrees Fahrenheit throughout the day. The heater was not going for the home, so we were cooling down the home throughout the whole day. So I would say we were fighting overall, just maintaining the temperature in the room, which we did pretty darn effectively and actually warmed it up a little bit. But let me know what you guys think. What would you do differently? This is kind of version two of a sand heater or a sand battery. It has a lot of potential, but there's a ton of improvements you can do than a simplified setup such as this. Now, if you guys need a little bit more help in terms of matching the right portable power station to your overall need, check out this video right here. I'll go over a larger portable power station, but that will also show you a generator inlet and how that setup works. Or one of those smaller units like a Delta 3 Plus, it'll go through all the calculations of how you understand what is your need compared to your critical appliances. And you can check out this video right here. It'll walk you through the complete process. So thanks for joining me in this video, and we'll catch you on one of those next ones. Take care.